Hey, baseball fans and fans of Most Valuable Podcast. I wasn't planning on doing this segment, but the Miami Marlins are a very interesting team in the National League this year, and I was going to actually save a topic like this one until after the trade deadline, but that's not how sports work. They don't work to appease me, so I'm going to appease you, the fan, by talking about the Miami Marlins, because my gosh, this team going into this season, and I had high expectations for them, but I didn't think they would be able to compete with the Mets and Nationals. I really didn't take them seriously. I thought that this would be a building year for them moving forward, but right now it looks like they're a playoff team, and I take them much more seriously than the Mets at this point. And it's kind of fun to follow along this Marlins team who are just a few years removed from that awful, awful rebuild that they were forced to go through. They had to get rid of Ozzie Guillen. They had all these moves, Mark Burley. They signed all these guys. Now they're doing it as the Marlins do it, and that's come up out of nowhere and just kick ass. Remember in 97 and even in 03, this is how the team goes for it all. And I bring up the Marlins because they were just involved in a trade. Yesterday, I believe it was, they, as I record this podcast, they traded for Andrew Cashner, Colin Ray, Teron Guerrero, and some cash in exchange for Carter Capps, Jared Cozart, Josh Naylor, first base prospect, and a minor league pitcher, Luis Castillo. Now, I'm going to break down all these names, and I'm going to break down the trade and who won, who lost, whatever, real quick. But I'm just really looking forward to this Miami Marlins playoff push because I very, very much take them seriously. I look at the standings. They're in second place in the NL East, 5 games behind the Nationals as I record this. They are currently tied with the St. Louis Cardinals in the second spot of the wild card in the National League. And I truly believe they're going to be in it till the end. It's interesting, though, because one of their main positions of need this season really focused within their starting rotation. Because Jose Fernandez, he's going to be on an innings limit. He's in a similar situation. The Marlins are in a similar situation as the Mets were with Matt Harvey and the Nationals were with Steven Strasburg a few years ago. It's going to be interesting to see if the Marlins are going to be ballsy enough to put Fernandez in these big spots, even if he does eclipse 180 innings. Keep an eye on that. However, they went this offseason, made a pretty sneaky, savvy signing by giving Wei-Yin Chen a contract because he can be one of those consistent guys at the top of the rotation and give you innings, give you a chance to win almost every time out. Currently dealing with an injury, so they have to be able to fill that void. But all of a sudden, you trade for Andrew Cashner, and prior to the Andrew Cashner trade, you go out and get a Fernando Rodney to bolster that bullpen with a bullpen that's actually one of the best in baseball, quietly. Marlins got something going here, and I'm really excited about the Marlins, even though I'll always hate the freaking Marlins, but that's okay. That's, you know, past. Well, this is my opinion. But this year, their lineup, they have some of the youngest players in baseball who are performing to an above average ability, especially look at Christian Yelich. Christian Yelich is developing into one of the top young players in the big leagues. Marcell Ozuna in center, patrolling center field, has done a fantastic job over the last few seasons with the Marlins. Giancarlo Stanton had one of the worst starts of his career. Honestly, among all of National League hitters, he was one of the worst going into July. Started to pick it up recently. He's starting to look like the Giancarlo Stanton we're used to. Moving on to Martin Prado. Prado's hot. He's that placeholder over at third base who's doing a rock-solid job over there. Danny Echevarria, sure-handed shortstop. D. Gordon's back. D. Gordon is back from his suspension. He served his PED. And now we look at what this roster is constructed as after this trade. So they get a guy and Andrew Cashner. And I'm going to be honest, Andrew Cashner isn't this top of the rotation guy that you can rely on because he's inconsistent. He's been inconsistent all of his career. He's always dealing with some sort of injury. Throws hard, big time, throws gas. Could be look to be a dominant starter early in his career. Spent some time in the bullpen, but once he was traded to the Padres from the Cubs, they really pushed him to be a starter and didn't find much success. I mean, he had a couple good seasons. Other than that, it's just been meh. But in a new system, let's see, in a playoff push, with the Marlins, maybe Cashner performs a little bit better. He's got a 4.76 ERA and 79 in the third innings this year. He's going to be a free agent after this season, so the Marlins are looking to reap the benefits of him and let him walk, most likely. Colin Ray. Colin Ray is a nice little pickup for them. It's kind of what the Marlins do best. You know, they have to find and replenish young talent over and over again because they just don't have the payroll to compete with top-of-the-market teams. So with Colin Ray, he's a young star. He's 25 years old. He's got only ERA pushing 5 right now in almost 100 innings. But you look at that, and you can build off of him. I think the Marlins are very happy in the return of Colin Ray. You can also use him in the bullpen, because right now it looks like the starters are going to be Fernandez until they shut him down. Still have Adam Conley. He looks okay. Looks pretty good, having a decent season. Then you have Cashner. Tommy Kohler is not doing very well overall. Jose Urrea as well. So, I mean, you can be confident in that, but I think the Marlins feel a lot better after this trade, for sure. Now, Teron Guerrero, he's another young prospect, kind of. He spent 7 years in the minors. He's still working his way to the majors. He's had some exposure in the big leagues, hasn't had much success, but maybe the Marlins can fix him. Maybe the Marlins can turn him into something. Maybe they can flip him. Who knows? They also got some cash, but whatever. On the other side, the San Diego Padres. Now, we look at the San Diego Padres, and we understand where they are as a ball club. They sold early, traded Drew Pomeranz to the Boston Red Sox, got a really a nice prospect in return for that. And also, they got some decent value in return for this trade. Carter Capps, Jared Cozart, first base prospect Josh Naylor, and Luis Castillo, as I mentioned. Carter Capps, if you all remember, he's the one who has the funky delivery as a relief pitcher. He jumps, and this, to me, it's illegal. I don't know how anybody can get away with this, because what he does is his back foot off the rubber comes off the ground, and he literally jumps forward like 5 or 6 inches during his delivery. And I say that should be illegal because as the pitch is delivered, your back foot is, instead of the ball coming at you 60 feet, 6 inches away from the hitter's perspective, it's coming at you at 60 feet straight up. So that's illegal. That's kind of butchering the system right there. But hey, it works for him. He's a power arm, recovering currently from Tommy John surgery. 24 years old, 1.16 ERA and 31 innings pitched in 2015. Looks fantastic as a reliever. Almost super dominant, but that freaking motion, I can't stand it. As a hitter, I would hate it. But that's a big boost to that Padres bullpen. That's something that I'm sure they're excited about. Jared Cozart. Jared Cozart came from Houston, was traded to Miami, and you know what? He had a lot of potential. A lot of teams, a lot of scouts, a lot of people wrote up about Jared Cozart. They said that he was going to become something great. But right now, it's not looking too good now 4 years into his major league career. He's got an overall ERA of 3.69. Okay, so it's not terrible. It's not terrible. But lately, you know, 4.52 ERA in 2015, pushing 6. He started the league. I'm sorry, Jared Cozart, he started the year with the Marlins at the Major League Club, but then got sent down. Now, since Wei-Yin Chen got hurt, he got called up and in 4 starts posted almost 6 ERA, which is not very good. But now he's on a Padres team where there's no pressure. He could develop into a nice little starting pitcher for the Padres. That's a rotation piece that the Padres should be excited about, because I don't think he's reached his MLB potential yet. He's shown flashes, that's for sure. And in a pitcher's ballpark in San Diego, he could capitalize on it. So that's exciting for the Padres. I really like the deal for both sides. It makes a lot of sense, but the overall winner has to be the Marlins right now, because they're getting starting rotation boost for a playoff push, obviously. And they got a nice young pitcher in Colin Ray that I feel like can develop into something better than what he is already. The return of D. Gordon. The return of D. Gordon is also going to be huge. I really do. Huge. When I say huge, it reminds me of Donald Trump. But I digress. But I really do. I'm really looking forward to this Marlins team. I really like Christian Yelich a lot. I think he's going to emerge as a top player in Major League Baseball. Maybe even next season. It's something. They got something really good going on down there in Miami, despite their restrictions in payroll and well, quite frankly, incompetence over the last few years in their front office. But now, future look, like in 97, like in 03 when they won their World Series, this is how they go for it. They get a bunch of no-names, and then they go. And they hit on one season, and they win it. So keep an eye on the Marlins. They're definitely going to be a playoff threat. I actually consider them a bigger threat than the Mets at this point. So awesome trade. Baseball season's in full swing. I'm looking forward to what happens before the deadline.